this emergency. What's the emergency?
Three men have just run into a car in the road, and they've just run off. And it's hit a few cars. It's hit my husband's car, my neighbour's car. It's gone into the wall.
So we've been asked to attend an immediate incident. It's been graded for us to travel there as fast as we can on blues and twos.
Is there anybody in the car? There is somebody in the car and they're injured.
The crash that PC James Gill and Rich Elliott are heading to is thought to involve five cars. The driver who caused it has done a runner.
When you run away from something like that, that shows guilt to me. You're not willing to take responsibility for your actions.
One person's reported to be trapped in their car, so James's priority when they get there is to find them and assess their injuries.
All right, the road is completely blocked.
Well, we need it here.
Yeah.
James runs ahead and spots the first smashed car, a small white Fiat.
Is this your car, sir? Are you injured? All right.
James urgently needs to find anyone who's trapped.
You're OK, are you?
OK.
The other four cars involved appear to be much further up the road, on the other side. One of these, a smashed-up black Seat, is the car that caused the crash, but all the occupants have run away. James is told a man is trapped in the red Suzuki.
OK, can I just get through? Excuse me, guys, can I get through? Sorry, can I get through, please? You're all right. Yep, sir, you're all right?
Yes, I'm a bit confused, but...
OK. Were you a passenger in this vehicle, I take it?
I'm a little bit confused.
OK, I'm James. All right, mate. Does it hurt anywhere? Are you injured?
No.
The man's not wearing a seatbelt, so the collision could have jolted him across the car, making it difficult for him to get out.
He was able to tell me his first name, but there was nothing much more than that. He couldn't remember where he'd been within the vehicle or how he came up to be in the position that he was, which was his feet in the driver's footwell, his body firmly lodged on the passenger side of the car.
As the first responder to the scene, James gives the fire service and paramedics a summary.
He's very confused, though, so I think there might be something else, as it were, from physical injury. He's got no physical injury that I can see, certainly. Guys, could I just ask, just while we get everyone sorted, if everyone could move back for us?
Just let it be his wife. My husband's in
the car. Okay. Were you in the car as well? No, that's fine.
The crash happened outside the woman's house. Her husband had only just got in the car on his way to buy a takeaway.
Obviously, with any situation like this, it's quite difficult to get a handle on straight away. It's only from eyewitnesses that we've been told he was actually within the car and setting out to go and collect some food.
A badly damaged Toyota has no one trapped inside.
November Victor.
The fourth vehicle was an empty parked Alfa Romeo.
There is another vehicle further up where ours is, and there was a guy standing on the road. I don't know if there was any damage to it. And then if someone could go and have a chat with the guy up there, if that's possible.
With all injured people being treated, James and Rich can now focus on the car that caused the crash and the driver and passengers who were seen running away.
There's been three guys all ran on.
Did you see them?
No, there's a guy down there with a bald head.
Okay.
He's got really
Thanks, guys.
Another witness tells James he thinks the Seat is on false plates because of something he's seen on a mobile phone inside the car.
Yep.
So I've pressed the button on the screen. If you look at the screensaver, it's this car.
Right.
It's on a high-reg.
Oh, right, OK. I'm with you.
When it comes to these things, I love the help that the public provide us. But when it comes to recovering evidence, I'd like us to be responsible for that, just solely, because then there's no chance that it's been tampered with.
The amateur detective may have contaminated any fingerprints on the phone, but he's given the cops a very interesting lead.
It's on one set of registration plates. However, there's a mobile phone inside, and on that mobile phone, there is a picture of the same car, but with an entirely different registration. So we're doing some background checks on that at the moment.
Rich has been checking the number plates shown on the mobile phone.
Nice one, yeah, that's the one.
And the chassis number of the car.
So it's confirmed false plates?
It's confirmed false plates. It is that one that's on that phone.
Yeah.
So I'll just go and seize that phone now. Fire brigade just making all the vehicles safe. They're not going to go inside it, so we can get a full forensic lift for that. Obviously, with the airbags, DNA and whatnot.
The car is on false plates, which is often an indicator that it's been stolen. But so far, there are no reports to confirm that. There may be other reasons why the driver has fled. James and Rich are hopeful they'll have enough clues to find the offender.
We've got good chance for forensics. The airbags are deployed on the vehicle that we're looking at, so there'll be some DNA from there.
This is the phone. So, the phone is turned off when we seize it. However, you could see on the screensaver that it had a number of missed calls, 5 missed calls in total from 2 different numbers. So obviously we're going to be doing a little bit of a work on those numbers to see who may be using them, and they may be linked to the occupants or indeed one of the other occupants, because there's 3 of them in total, we're being told.
Lots of witnesses saw the 3 men.
They did not go right.
Didn't go far.
Okay.
And you've not seen them cross at all?
No.
But one in particular got a good look at them.
White male, say 19, 20 tops, supply out.
Okay, and describe his hair to me. Everything was nicely lit up by the street lighting that was there, so that he's got a sort of perfect opportunity to see the people coming from the car and retain that in his memory. Would you recognise him again?
Oh, sure, yeah.
Okay. Mate, what you've given me is very helpful, and the fact that you can remember these people again is going to be very useful. We've got a chap there who's potentially quite badly injured.
Exactly right.
People shouldn't get away with doing things like that.
A recent report shows there were over 17,000 hit and runs per year in the UK. James now has a clearer picture of how this crash happened.
We've got a little Fiat further up the road, which was looking to turn into this array of shops. As he's gone to turn, a vehicle has come down the road at speed and clipped him. That sent that vehicle out of control, striking parked cars, which have been parked outside these addresses here, and then obviously coming to a rest as it is.
The injured man who was in one of the parked cars has gone off to hospital, and the recovery trucks are taking all the smashed cars away.
We're going to pursue them for dangerous driving. The amount of injury that this could have caused, the amount of damage that it has caused, is significant. There is no reason for people to be driving at such speeds in conditions such as this. It's reckless, it's careless, it's not what you would expect from a road user. So we will look to identify these people and prosecute them accordingly.
Through a mixture of forensics, descriptions, and intelligence, the police managed to track down the suspect. At court, the young man pleaded guilty to driving without due care and attention, without insurance, with only a provisional license, fraudulent use of number plates, and failing to report the crash. He was banned from driving for 3 months and had to pay a total of £503 in fines, costs, and victim surcharge.